Hi, Emmanuel. My name is Rochelle, and I would like to welcome you to our worship service today. Wherever you are watching from today, you are welcome to be a part of our worshiping community here at Emmanuel Baptist Church. Even though we cannot be together in community, we are united together by God's Spirit into one body. May you feel the touch of God's Spirit as we worship today. Thank you.
Let us gather together as the people of God as we worship today. Psalm 107 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, whose steadfast love endures forever. Let the faithful give thanks to the Lord." So let us lift up our hearts and voices in praise and adoration. Let us pray. God of immeasurable grace, you meet us in our time of need and cause your face to shine upon us. You sent your Son into the world that we might be saved, and you fashioned us into vessels of your love and light. Redeem us this day, O God, that we may be found worthy of the one who came to bring us life. Amen.
Rejoice, give thanks, and sing, and triumph. finding myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Good morning, Emmanuel. This is the prayer for the children. Lord, we thank you, God, for this day and for the love you show us. Your love never ends, and you are with us through all the ups and downs of life. We pray a blessing over the children, Lord, that you would keep them safe and that they would continue to learn and know the never-ending depth of your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. My name is Marg Sirska, and today's scripture reading will be taken from John chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of the light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning, everyone, and happy springtime. I hope you felt a sense of optimism and joy that came with this lovely warm weather this past week. Some of you may be starting to feel a sense of hopeful optimism. You know, we're starting to become cautiously optimistic as the second wave of COVID continues to decrease. And with the news that vaccinations have already dramatically reduced infection levels in seniors' residences in Ontario. Of course, there is still the third wave with new variants to contend with, but if we all stay the course and continue to wear masks in public, maintain physical distancing, and wash our hands frequently, we will get through this in due time. Actually, there is one other thing that we need to contend with. The conspiracy theories that are floating around concerning vaccinations. You know, when the U.S. Capitol attack happened on January the 6th, it has really opened our eyes to see how widespread various conspiracy theories have become. And the anti-vaccination crowd could cause serious delays in bringing this global pandemic under control. Speaking of vaccinations, I saw an interview with Bill Gates recently. Aside from being the founder of Microsoft Corporation and one of the richest people in the world, Bill Gates is also noteworthy for two other things. First of all, he gave a TED Talk in 2014 identifying the need for the world to prepare for a global epidemic similar to SARS. And he warned that the U.S. was not prepared to deal with this threat. And secondly, he has personally donated over $60 billion, that's billion with a B, of his own money to fund research into efforts to rid the world of diseases like malaria and tuberculosis. So in this interview, the interviewer asked a very pointed question. He said the internet was supposed to usher in this information age when factual information would be easy to access, but it doesn't look like it's bringing us there. Have you thought about the current state of the internet? And Bill Gates responded, well, the internet has done something fantastic. If you want, you have the opportunity to learn about science and what's going on, and that just wasn't there before. A lot of people are so much more informed. And then he went on to speak about the impact of the conspiracy theories, saying, quote, in the case of anti-vaccines, it may slow down how quickly we get lots of people to get the vaccine and therefore extend the epidemic and cost us in tens of thousands of lives. You know, that's typical Bill Gates. He didn't get into the politics of it. He just gave an educated guess about how many people will die, like he is running a giant spreadsheet in his head. Well, I don't know what you think about vaccinations, but as far as I'm concerned, I think I need to be absolutely clear. Don't believe the conspiracies. Don't be driven by fear. I believe when it's your turn, when it's my turn, we should be vaccinated. It's the way forward if we ever hope to get through this pandemic. And right now, if you're over 80 years old, it's your turn to register for a vaccination. And if you require any assistance with registration or transportation, please stay tuned to the end of the service today for some information about assistance that we would like to make available to you. So let me just circle back to the question asked by the young man who interviewed Bill Gates. The internet promised to usher in a golden age of access to information. And to a large degree, as Bill Gates observed, it's true. Never has there been a time in history when there's been such remarkable access to information as there is today. Whether you want to research your family history, watch the construction of the ITER nuclear fusion reactor in France, learn a new language, find out what day of the week you were born on, access libraries, journals, and periodicals, see images of Mars from the Perseverance rover, or go shopping in stores anywhere in the world. You can do all of these things and many more things today. But there's also a dark side to the internet. And we have seen it in the polarization of politics, in the exploitation of our personal data by technology companies who have no accountability, in the proliferation of scams and fraud online, and in these wild conspiracies that are spreading and that will lead to countless more deaths due to COVID if fear-mongering about vaccines continues. It is also the golden age of disinformation. So having access to all this information, both reputable and not reputable, places a significant burden upon us to exercise discernment. Today, more than ever, we all need to develop the skill of critical thinking so that we're able to carefully weigh the validity of what people say, whether it's the scammer on the phone, or the posts you read on social media, or even the news reports that you watch. Sometimes conspiracies and disinformation can be relatively harmless, but there are some areas in life where it is very important to get your answers from a credible source. Thursday, I did an internet search. What is the meaning of life? In 1.03 seconds, I had 1.1 billion web pages on the topic. Yes, again, billion with a B. And you'll be happy to know that I read all of them in preparation for my message today. No, you know that's not true. It would take a lifetime just to casually browse 1.1 billion websites. So is this the golden age of information, or is it really the age of TMI? Who can you trust? Who's right and who's wrong? And how will you know the truth when you see it? These are big questions. These are important questions. Asking good questions can be a bit of a lost art these days. Asking good questions requires humility and an openness to admit that there is yet more that we can learn and discover. It is wise to ask more questions before offering answers, to learn and discover more each day rather than simply to coast on the things that we have learned long ago. I would encourage you not to be cynical or closed-minded, but rather learn to be curious-minded, looking for truth, for what's real and trustworthy, always refusing to accept the banality of shallow answers as you continue to dig deeper in the pursuit of truth. The scripture reading from the third chapter of John's Gospel started at verse 14, the scripture reading we had just a few moments ago. But the context of these verses are prompted by the 13 verses that preceded it. It was the nighttime visit of Nicodemus, who came to Jesus asking questions. You know, Nicodemus was a Pharisee and a member of the Jewish ruling council. He was a big man, a leader, someone who was held in high esteem. And he had spent his life studying the scriptures and was an expert in the law. But Nicodemus was curious about Jesus. He realized there was something dynamic, something remarkable about this young prophet from Galilee. And yet, because of his experience and his education, I'm sure Nicodemus felt that there was some kind of fundamental dissonance between his own expectations about the Messiah and the message and the lifestyle that he saw portrayed by Jesus. Many of Nicodemus's fellow ruling council members were cynical and closed-minded. They had already made up their minds about Jesus. But Nicodemus was at least willing to meet him face to face and ask questions. If we look at the conversation from the point of view of Nicodemus, it's really interesting and almost comical, because the answers that Jesus gives him leaves him baffled and confused. For example, in John 3, verse 3, Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." Right from the start, Nicodemus, is absolutely flummoxed. How can someone be born when they're old? He asked. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born again. And then after Jesus tells him about the Spirit moving like the wind, Nicodemus replies in verse 9, how can this be? And Jesus said to him, you are Israel's teacher, and you do not understand these things. Well, you have to give Nicodemus credit for standing there. He was probably embarrassed, and others most likely would have just thrown up their hands in frustration, declaring Jesus to be mad or confused or a heretic speaking nonsense. But not Nicodemus. How can this be? He asked. Here we see this man of answers who has just asked a question that would lead to the most wonderful answer ever spoken. In this world of questions and this myriad of answers out there, there's really just one answer that rises to the top, only one answer that truly satisfies our human longings. When we see it, when we experience it, we know how it is. We know that it is the deepest and most precious aspect of human existence. And the answer is love. Love is the deepest and greatest answer. I wonder if you've seen the film Love Actually. Some people really love it, other people not so much. But the film starts and ends at Heathrow Airport in London, showing scenes of families reunited, hugging and kissing and jumping for joy because they see their loved ones again. And Hugh Grant, who is speaking as the British Prime Minister, says over this scene, whenever I get gloomy with the state of the world, I think about the arrivals gate at Heathrow Airport. General opinions starting to make out that we live in a world of hatred and greed, but I don't see that. It seems to me that love is everywhere. Often it's not particularly dignified or newsworthy, but it's always there. Fathers and sons, mothers and daughters, husbands and wives, boyfriends, girlfriends, old friends. If you look for it, I've got a sneaking feeling that you'll find that love actually is all around. Another deeply personal example is the song by Jason Mraz called Love is Still the Answer. If you get a chance to watch the video, you really have to see it. Because he said to people who are fans of his music, point your cameras in the direction of love. And then he put all of those videos together into a video montage while he sings his song. And it is absolutely a masterpiece. I hope that you'll look it up and watch this video online on YouTube. Actually, I'd like to sing a part of it for you now. Okay. The question is why? Why are we here? Say our hellos and goodbyes, then disappear. This beautiful life, what is it for? To learn how to master peace or master war? There's only one answer that matters, even if your heart has been shattered. Whatever you want, whatever you are after, love is the answer. Love is
is still the answer.
It's a beautiful song. The obsession of poets and songwriters, the deepest and most life-giving emotion we can experience is love. Now, Hugh Grant, admittedly, is not a prophet, and as far as I know, Jason Mraz is not a saint. But they have both put their finger on the pulse of this most treasured human experience of love. Love that lifts our hearts and makes our lives hopeful and vibrant, joyful and meaningful. If you have ever been loved, if you've ever loved someone else deeply, you will know that it produces life's greatest joy. And paradoxically, it can also lead us to the deepest of sorrows when those bonds of love are severed through death or separation. Love is the answer. And this brings us back to Nicodemus and Jesus. And as I read this passage again this past week, I started to think about that phrase, you must be born again. And I started to think about it in a different way. You know, maybe Jesus was really saying to Nicodemus, you have studied the scriptures your whole life, and your head is brimming with answers for every theological, ethical, or moral question. And you thought you were coming here for answers, for certainty, but what you really need is to become like a child all over again, to set aside all that learning and open your eyes to the wonder and delight of life, to feel the warmth of the sunshine on your face, to wonder at the beauty as you sit in a park bench in a place like Edwards Gardens, soaking up the natural beauty of nature around you, to experience the awesome feeling of laying on your back and looking up at the stars. You need to be born again and start asking questions like a 3-year-old. Why? Well, however Jesus intended it, John's gospel moves beyond this conversation and records these most wonderful words we could ever hear. The gospel in shorthand recorded in John 3:16. Wherever you are right now, say these words out loud with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. This is the final answer to life's million-dollar question. And I'll tell you why it's so important and why it goes far beyond the simple statement, love is still the answer. It's because human love, as wonderful as it is often marred by or interrupted by human frailty and failings. I don't know about you, but sometimes I hear a love song on the radio and it makes me feel happy. You know, for example, John Denver's song, Annie's Song. Come, let me love you. Let me give my life to you. Let me drown in your laughter. Let me die in your arms. You fill up my senses. Come, fill me again. It's a beautiful love song. And then you hear that John and Annie divorced in 1982. Or Stevie Wonder, I just called to say I love you. You know, he's written so many amazing songs. But Stevie Wonder, about love? How many children? How many wives? Now listen, I don't want to pick on anyone. I'm just saying when it comes to love, we know it when we see it. We love to be loved and to experience it in all of its fullness. But as human beings, we can fall short of our ambition to be a loving person. And sometimes we can even end up hurting the ones we love. Which is why John 3:16 is so important because it points us beyond human love to God's love. Because God's love goes beyond our capacity to understand or express love. How is God's love different? Well, just look at that first verse. He gave. The focus of verses 16 and 17 is the gift of God's Son, Jesus. God chose to love us by sending His Son, even though we don't deserve His love or forgiveness. It is His initiative that has led to the gift of His Son, Jesus. He gave His Son so that we might receive forgiveness and ultimately the gift of eternal life. And this great gift of God's love resonates through the pages of Scripture as the early believers were captivated by the wonder of God's gift to us all. Take, for example, Romans chapter 5, verse 8, "But God demonstrates His own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." And it is the death of Jesus on the cross that really spells out for us in writ large the incomparable love God has for us. It wasn't simply that He sent His Son. No, God's love was demonstrated through His sacrifice on the cross when He gave His life for us. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. This cross has become the symbol of God's incomparable love. For through Christ's death and resurrection, we are forgiven and we experience new life through faith in Him. We are changed forever as we discover life in Christ, a life of purpose, a life of meaning, a full and rich life in His love. So Jason Mraz was on the right track. The question is why? Why are we here? Love is still the answer. But the ultimate answer, the one that he missed, this one crucial part, is that love has a name. And His name is Jesus. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. This is God's free gift of grace. One life given so that you can be saved, so that you will not perish but have eternal life, so that your eyes will be opened to see the wonder of God's love and know that you are a child of God. And you are loved. You are loved with a pure, holy love that will never fade, will never hurt you. It is the only love that literally lasts forever. Years ago, I was visiting a church and I saw this picture in the fellowship room. It's by Harry Anderson and entitled, "What happened to your hand?" And I just love this image because of the innocence and the honesty of the little girl's question. You know, if there were adults nearby, they would probably scold her and say, "No, no, dear, you mustn't ask that question, anything but that." But this is not an adult. She's a child innocently asking a child's question. And how would Jesus respond? I'm quite certain He would say, "These are an expression of my love for you, dear child." So what about you? Are you willing to be born again so you can begin seeing the world through the eyes of a child with a fresh sense of curiosity, wonder, and amazement as you begin to see more clearly each day how deeply God loves you? Let's just pause for a few moments as we reflect on God's great love as we read these passages of Scripture.
At this time, let us unite our hearts and minds in the congregational prayer. I'm Heidi Ojo. Love has a name. It is Jesus. Thank you for God's one and only Son, who is our intercessor. We lay down our burdens in faith and receive rest and peace. Praise the Lord for his never-ending love that exceeds our understanding. May we flourish in that love. Make us a people who are sensitive to the needs around us and ready to respond with kindness and encouragement. Love is the oil to the wheels of our obedience. Psalm 42 promises that the Lord will send his faithful love by day. His song will be with us at night. Forgive us when we doubt or seek after the lesser things of the world. Thank you for mercy and grace, and help us by your Spirit to grow deeper in the love of Jesus. We pray for comfort, peace, and strength for those in our church family who are grieving losses. We pray for Sadie and her family at the loss of Theo Adams. We pray for Joyce Morrison at the loss of her brother in Jamaica. And we pray for Diane and her family at the loss of Uraline Briggs. Thank you for the assurance that their loved one now dwells in the fullness of Christ. We ask for the presence of the Holy Spirit during the service to celebrate the life of each one. Guide those who walk us alongside those who are grieving to bring emotional and spiritual support and care. We affirm that Emmanuel is a welcoming church, and we ask that you continue to strengthen your people in this calling. We pray particularly for newcomers and seekers, that they would have an authentic experience of you through the Easter services here. Lord, grant the teachers and the parents of the children and youth at Emmanuel, Lord, bless them with creativity, grace, and kindness to teach impactful lessons. We thank you for the members of Emmanuel Iranian Congregation who are ministering to the community in the Farsi language. We ask, too, that they would grow deeper in your love. We lift up the pastors, deacons, and ministry leaders to be strengthened in righteousness, wisdom, and joy in the Lord. We ask for guidance and unity in the discernment of God's direction together. I pray your blessings over the church, for your people to be renewed in health, job, happiness, according to deepening faith. Thank you for your sustaining presence through periods of trial. You truly are a light in the darkness. May the Spirit remind us of your love and promises as we recite together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, your name be honored as glory, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Well, this morning I'd like to introduce a new element to our worship services called the Ministry Highlight. You know, there are many things that are happening in the life of our church, and we're not always aware of these things. And we also have ministry partnerships with other organizations and ministries that we would like to feature and really share the good work that we're doing together. So today, I'd like to start by sharing about Stephen Ministries. You've heard about it before, but today we wanted to play a brief video and just to encourage people to know more about what we do with Stephen Ministries, so that you can either access the ministry yourself if you're going through a difficult time, or if you know somebody who could benefit from Stephen Ministry, you might refer them for assistance. So here is our video to promote Stephen Ministries. Music.
my father-in-law passed away, and then 1 week later, my wife died, had a massive heart attack at the age of 47. I was making the arrangements at church, of course, with our funeral coordinator, and the pastor stepped in. And so during the conversation of setting up the funeral arrangements, he suggested that I get a Stephen minister. So it wasn't anything that I had thought about at that point, and I didn't really think that I needed one. So I'm a deacon. I'm also a Stephen minister. I don't need a Stephen minister. But I was grieving. And so it was that following Monday where I did actually meet my Stephen minister. And it was then where he asked, you know, just general, how you doing? Did you need anything kind of questions? And then it was that first probing question. Tell me how you really feel. And then it was just like, blah, you know. It just, everything comes out, all the floodgates come, that wall just shatters down. And then that was such a burden off my shoulders. It was unbelievable. He was a football player when he was in high school, and then he also played college football. And to see this tough guy asking me these very soft and tender questions, is kind of what helped break down that initial tough guy wall that I had up. I can expose some of those inner weaknesses that I was going, what I was experiencing at that time, because this tough guy was so tender, was so caring, was so loving. And seeing how my Stephen minister reached out, he as he kept reaching, those questions that were making me probe, and I, how's your heart, and how are you, how is your mind thinking, those questions, I just saw Jesus asking me those same questions, reaching out to give me a hug.
Morning, Emmanuel. This is the time in our service where we would take up our offering. There are so many different ways that you can be donating to our ministries at Emmanuel. You can be dropping off your envelopes through the mailbox at the church, or be mailing your offering in. There's also online donations that you can be making, paragiving, and things like that. And this is the way that we support our ministries that we've been doing over these couple months and years. So join me as we pray for our ministries and for our offering. God, thank you so much that we can gather together online. I pray that you bless our ministries as we continue to serve our community and our neighborhood. God, we just pray that you would bless our offerings. We pray that you would bless the leaders and volunteers that help out with so many different ministries like Alpha and Children's Ministry and Youth Ministry and so many more. God, we just pray that you be with us. Help us to be a light in our neighborhood and also during this dark times. We just pray that you would continue to bless our community and that we would be able to serve our neighborhood and our church family in so many different ways. In your name we pray. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, worship His holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day. time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship His holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship His holy name.
Morning, Emmanuel. We are so happy that you joined us this Sunday at our online service. This is the time in our service where we share the opportunities and different ways that you can stay connected with Emmanuel. So we would like to let you know that if you're 80 years old and above, there's an opportunity for you to get vaccinated. You can make an appointment online or call to book an appointment as well. But if you would like some help in that area, we do have volunteers who'd be willing to help out to book an appointment for you or call for you to book an appointment to get vaccinated. So if you like help in that way, please contact Carmen James Henry or the church office for more information, and they'll put you together with a volunteer who can help you out with that. Also, we do need volunteers to be willing to drive these seniors to their vaccination appointments. Some of them are not able to get there on their own, so we do need help getting them there to get vaccinated. We would really appreciate it. So if you'd like to volunteer and help out in this way, please contact Carmen James Henry or the church office for more information. There's also another way that you can participate in our church service. On Easter Sunday, we are going to be having an Easter greeting. So we would love to get videos of you and your family members saying Happy Easter in English or in a different language. So please send those 5 to 20 second videos to me or the church office. We would love to see some familiar faces, and I would love to hear from you guys in this way and have you participate in our service in this manner. Also, there's so much information at emmanuelbaptist.ca. If you'd like to know more about the Ladies Tuesday Bible Study, children's ministries, the youth ministry, Alpha, and so many other things, there's information on our church website about those different ministries and how you can connect and participate in those areas. This is our benediction for this Sunday. Look to the Lord and His strength. Seek His face always. As you head out throughout the week, may you search for God in your day-to-day and see and notice where He's at work in your life. May you notice how He's provided for your needs. May you feel His love and presence as you work from home, go to school, and so many other things. May you show God's love to others as well throughout this next week. Oh.